Right, well, you will get started. So welcome. Thank you for taking the time to attend this information session for the Solutions Program. I'm Karen Tilsley, Director of Programs and Partnerships with SHRF. So really appreciate you taking the time to join today. Hoping I can provide some more context and answer any questions about the content in the application package. And if you're watching this on YouTube after today, then thank you for taking the time to do that. And feel free to reach out and contact me about any questions you have. To start, I want to take a moment to acknowledge that I'm speaking to you from Treaty 6 lands in Saskatoon. Happy to be inside with the air conditioning. Not gonna lie, it is very hot out there. Not totally my jam, but maybe let the kids play in the sprinklers later to enjoy this summer weather. And yeah, I acknowledge that we have people joining from all over the province from different lands. So we'll just take a moment to acknowledge where we are today. Okay, so just so you know, this session is being recorded. As I mentioned, it will be posted on SHRF's YouTube channel. So if you ask any questions today through the Q&A box, I can answer those, and that will be part of the recording. Everyone is muted. This is just a presentation. I have both a question and answer and a chat box open. So if you write in either of those, I will see them. And if it's something I feel I should answer right away, I'll do that. Otherwise, I will leave time at the end for a more focused question and answer period. All right, we'll get started. So I'll just spend a couple of minutes talking about SHRF, and then we'll go into the details of the program, the layers within the funding opportunities and the focus areas. Talk about timelines, the funding available, and then focus in on what you need to do to apply, how the applications are reviewed, and just finish up with a few quick tips and give you lots of time to ask any questions. So SHRF is the provincial organization that funds, supports, and promotes the impact of health research that matters to Saskatchewan. And we have a high-level strategic plan that outlines strategic goals where we're looking in all of our activities, including the research funding programs that we offer to strengthen research capacity and competitiveness, increase investment in research and innovation, and align with stakeholders' needs. So the Solutions Program really addresses all of those, and you can see that through partnerships, we're able to increase investment in research through the focus areas we're looking to align with stakeholder needs, and generally through involving many different people on your teams and conducting this research in general, we're looking to strengthen the capacity and competitiveness. So when we look at our funding programs overall, we work within a bit of a framework, and there's four overarching themes. So the Solutions Program is what we're talking about today, and it's where we focus on supporting research across the continuum from early stages and onwards to make a focused impact in an area. So that's what today's webinar is focused on. And you can also find information on our website about our Connections program, where we have the Research Connections grant for knowledge mobilization and the new Align grant for that early stage work before applying for SHRF national or international funding to make sure that your work is aligned and relevant and feasible. And you could use an Align grant in preparation for this Solutions program call, so keep that in mind. All right, so the Solutions program specifically has a purpose to address timely Saskatchewan health challenges, create that sustainable impact in a focused area, and mobilize the research community and partners' skills, resources, and perspectives. So we're really looking to bring together those people, organizations from the different sectors, different perspectives that really come together to address that focus area. So within this program, we have two funding mechanisms. The first being the Innovation Grant, which is for 1 year and $50,000. And importantly, is the objective of the grant is focused on catalyzing innovative new ideas and approaches. So, then the Impact Grant is for 2 years and $150,000. And this is where the research is being translated into real world settings and practical applications. So it's important to focus on the objective of the grant and not just think about if you want a longer grant with more money. If your research doesn't align well with the objective of the impact grant, then the peer reviewers will notice that, and vice versa. If your research would be better for an impact grant, but you're only applying for the innovation, then there'll be some misalignment and the review won't be as favorable in that sense. And if you want to talk this through, we can try to answer any questions you have. Ultimately, the decision will be yours, your team's, to decide which funding mechanism is a best fit for your project. We've had the Solutions Program. This is the third year, and we've sort of evolved the structure. As you can see, it's layered. So we have the funding mechanisms, and we also have the focus areas, and we have partners. So I'll try to make that as clear as possible. I know it can be a bit overwhelming. We have three different application packages. Generally, the application form is the same no matter which call you're applying to, but you have to make sure you're applying to the right call. So we have the SHRF focus areas, partnered focus areas, and the collective impact focus area. And you can only apply to one of these because we want you to be able to write your application appropriately for that particular focus area and grant, so that the reviewers can really see the alignment with the opportunity. So first I'll talk about the SHRF focus areas. We're actually continuing on with virtual care and addictions. Virtual care we offered 2 years ago, and addictions we offered last year, and we felt that there was still continued work that could be done in this area to advance the projects that have been underway and fund new projects that perhaps, even with COVID happening or many other reasons, that weren't ready for the first couple of rounds. So if you missed the first round of these, then this is your opportunity. So we also, within those focus areas, there's additional funding for applications related to patient-oriented research for addictions. And then in virtual care, we have Mental Health Research Canada as a partner and the Center for Aging and Brain Health Innovation as a partner. So those envelopes are separate, like virtual care plus mental health, or virtual care plus aging in place, addictions plus patient-oriented research, but you don't have to meet one of the partner requirements. You can just be doing virtual care in any setting. The SHRF Focus Application Guide really gives a long description of virtual care and what we mean by that. It's really quite inclusive. We try to set it up and I'll try to digest it a bit here for you. So we're looking to answer those questions and develop evidence on how virtual care can be used to improve patient-client experience and outcomes, ensure safe and equitable access to quality care, improve efficiency and appropriateness of care, reduce costs, enhance team-based care and coordination between providers and sectors. So you don't have to address all of these. These are examples of areas that your projects could look to measure and have develop evidence in those areas. As I mentioned, we have the two additional partnerships with the focus on mental health and virtual care, and aging in place and virtual care. Some examples, this could be developing evidence-informed practice for virtual care, the actual tools and applications, how those work or developing them, policy and governance, ethics, confidentiality, those kinds of things. We have, you know, the providers that need to be able to implement and use this in their work. So, you know, anything that looks at the healthcare provider and how they could use the virtual care tools or practices, empowering the patients, removing any barriers that they would have to accessing virtual care, and even the system level implementation. The second area is addictions. And so again, we're looking for you to address questions and develop evidence for improved access, experience and outcomes, culturally responsive care. We can be looking at effective strategies for prevention, treatment, recovery, policy and system improvements, and reaching out beyond just health. This could be looking at social services, corrections, anything like that, where the sectors, it would be beneficial for sectors to work together. And this is all along the continuum from education, prevention. So prevention could be preventing unmanaged pain. It could be looking at environmental factors. It could be harm reduction, treatment, recovery, anywhere along that spectrum. That is all eligible under addictions. And then there is additional funding for applications that are also patient-oriented. And so those come with some additional requirements and actually some additional steps in this case of the Skipper partnership. So I'll spend the next few slides just addressing those. So SHRF is a partner of Skipper, and we're invested, we're committed to investing in patient-oriented research in Saskatchewan. And so through this partnership, Skipper actually has additional services to support patient-oriented research. So the selected grant recipients will receive support in patient engagement, Indigenous research and engagement, data and data services, and capacity development. So it's just a really brief overview of some of the services that Skipper could provide to the recipients. Some additional requirements when you're applying for the patient-oriented Skipper partnership opportunity, there's a minimum of 2 patient partners on the application, and there's an extra step where you complete a survey that addresses the researcher's relevance to the Skipper's mandate. So the questions go through the criteria on the portlet. So there's a link there through Skipper's website where you can read about the portlet. There's tip sheets and lots of description about the criteria. And so applications need to score a minimum of 3 in each criterion to be eligible for partnership with Skipper. And wanted to take this opportunity to let anyone who's interested in the Skipper partnership know that there's a data support information session taking place on August 8th. So if that applies to you, make note of that. And if you're looking, if you have any questions about Skipper services, the data support, anything like that, your contact is Skipper Specialist Savannah Holt. And then there's another email address for data support, which I'm sure Savannah would be happy to give you as well. And I'll just take a moment here to say, so for example, if you applied to addictions and indicated a Skipper partnership interest, but let's say your application did not receive that minimum score of 3 on all of the portlet criteria through the patient review, your application would still be considered for the SHRF open addictions pool. So don't let that deter you, I guess, from, you know, if you think that that's an extra opportunity, don't let that deter you, because, yeah, you'll still be considered in the open competition. And the same with the virtual care partnerships. If you're not the selected grant for Mental Health Research Canada partnership or the CABI partnership, you're still considered in the virtual care funding open pool. And so moving on to the second application package, which talks about the partnered focus areas. And so just to continue the thought I was on there, in this case, the applications that are not funded do not have another pool to go into, because these focus areas are driven by the partners and the eligibility relevance is determined by the partner organization. So the two partners we have through this call this year are LungSask and Alzheimer's Society Saskatchewan, looking at lung health and Alzheimer's disease and other dementias. So the lung health focus area, to be eligible for that funding, there's a wide array of topics that are eligible, so have a look at those in the guide. If you have any questions, you can reach out to me and then I can connect you with the Lung Association if that's appropriate. We can coordinate that. And yeah, so it, just know that if you're applying here, then this is the only funding pool for those applications. And the same with Alzheimer's Society of Saskatchewan. A list here of the different areas that are relevant for research funding. And again, if you have questions about this, you can still contact myself and I can help coordinate with Alzheimer's Society of Saskatchewan for any questions about relevance. They are ultimately the people who make the decision about whether the application is relevant. And Alzheimer's Society Saskatchewan is also able to assist in identifying interested people with dementia and family caregivers that would benefit being involved in the project. Okay, so the third application package is called the Collective Impact Focus Area. So this is something special that we've been working towards for a few years now, actually. And we have a number of organizations coming together and we really appreciate the support, and there might be other organizations that are even able to join on later in the game. And yeah, we really appreciate it. It helps show the support for this research and get the word out, make those connections in the community and increase the funding available. So, yeah, so that there's not separate pools for each of these partners. This is a collective impact focus area. There's one focus area and all the partners are coming together to support that. Yeah, because there's issues that affect all our organizations and information that's, you know, relevant to one area might be relevant to another area. So yeah, so it's a group effort here. And the focus area is rural and remote healthcare. So we're looking to improve access to safe, integrated, quality healthcare for Saskatchewan's rural and remote residents. So the only impact grants are available for this opportunity. So no innovation grants are available for the rural and remote healthcare. All the other focus areas have both innovation and impact grants. So through these grants, we're looking to provide patient care as close to home as possible, improve care coordination, and recruit and retain healthcare providers. It's really important with these grants to work in concert with the health system at the appropriate levels, including local representation from those communities, the health system level decision makers that you're working with, to ensure that the project is relevant and could be incorporated in the health system. And there's two areas of focus within this, and that's the use of technology and empowering, connecting, training, supporting, number of things there, but focusing on the healthcare providers that are in those rural and remote communities. And you probably are noticing there's some overlap here when we talk about especially use of technology with rural and remote healthcare. There definitely is some overlap with the virtual care focus area. So if you're trying to just, you have to pick one. Of course, if it's an innovation grant, then that's only eligible for virtual care. If it's an impact grant, then feel free to call me and have a discussion. But as I'm, for this one, if you apply to either one, I'll just use the virtual care example, but it could be others, that you could, you have to apply to one, but you can still be considered for funding in the others following the review process. So the competition launched a couple of weeks ago, and the eligibility is currently open in the SHRF RMS. So there's three different calls that you'll see in the RMS and two different funding mechanisms. So make sure you click on the right one. So the cutoff for eligibility is September 29th, and then we have a chance still for another week to go back and forth if there's any questions. So for example, if you're applying to the lung focus area and the partner needs some more clarifying information to determine relevance, we have a chance to do that at the eligibility stage. And then the application deadline is November 17th. So that's where everything has to be submitted to SHRF through the RMS. Funding decisions are March 3rd, with that start date being March 1st next year. We gave ourselves a little more time this year to get decisions out so that we could coordinate with all our partners and confirm funding and really try to maximize the number of applications that we can fund across all three calls. This table breaks down the funding available. So there's essentially seven different pools. So there's $1 million available for addictions and virtual care, innovation and impact grants, and then additional funding, $200,000 available for patient-oriented research related to addictions. There's one impact grant available related to mental health and virtual care. There's funding available for virtual care plus aging, and then $200,000 available for applications relevant to lung health, $200,000 available for applications related to Alzheimer's disease and other dementias. And then with the collective impact focus area, rural and remote healthcare, we have a minimum of $450,000 together with our partners available. So when you're bringing together your team to develop and carry out this project, we break down the people involved into three categories, I guess. So the applicants is anyone that's contributing to the intellectual, cultural, or scientific direction of the project. And we have, we add descriptors on top of that. So you are either a researcher, a knowledge user, or a person with living experience. And then we have personnel. So those are people that are compensated from the grant funds. So if you have them in place, you can name them on the grant and demonstrate their expertise and involvement through the application. So those are trainees and research staff, essentially. Supporters are individuals or organization that have a really defined role in the project or at a certain time, or they have an interest in the outcome. So they provide a letter of support as part of the application. So the project team, three people is what we've considered the minimum of a team. So that includes two Saskatchewan-based researchers from different disciplines, and one of them needs to meet the requirement for the principal investigator and be at an institution that has an MOU currently with SHRF, and as well as one Saskatchewan-based knowledge user. And then you can have additional applicant or team members from outside the province, knowing that the money has to be spent in Saskatchewan. As long as everyone has a clear role, you can certainly have additional team members in any of those roles. So we've got the logos up there of the institutions that currently have an MOU with SHRF. So they take on some responsibility in ensuring ethics is in place for funded projects, managing the distribution of the funds, things like that. So that's an important relationship SHRF has with those institutions, and we have an MOU that outlines our roles there. So when you're putting together your project team, you want to consider the expertise needed for reviewers looking at the application, and you're measuring or doing some analysis, or you know, talking about a group of people, and there's nobody on the team that can really speak to that, then that's going to raise flags in the review for sure. You want to make sure that everyone that's involved can talk about why they're involved and what they're doing or what they're contributing. If you have an opportunity to show how you're building capacity and mentoring trainees and early career researchers, that's an important part of grant funding for SHRF and others, including people with lived living experience. It's not a requirement for the SHRF. It's not a requirement for all the focus areas, but it's where it's warranted. It's certainly important to have those people, and some of the focus areas and partner requirements do indicate specifically that you need to have people with lived experience on the team. And then relevant supporters. So are there, you know, any healthcare system decision makers, community leaders, organization, industry partners, anything like that, that you want to show their support for your project? So we're talking here about multiple applications, reapplications, renewal. So principal applicants are restricted to one application per year for the solutions program overall. So that's the funding mechanisms, the focus areas, that one application across the board that applies only to the principal applicant role. And as I've mentioned, where it's appropriate, you could still be considered for funding in other pools. So yeah, if you're concerned about that, just let me know. It makes sense in our heads how this will all play out through the review process and funding allocation, but if you have questions, let me know. If you've applied to, for example, virtual care or addictions or any other competition and been unsuccessful, we encourage you to revise and resubmit, and be sure to use the space provided on the application form to talk about how you've addressed reviewer comments. That's really important. And if you do have a solution, innovation, or impact grant from the last 2 years, you can still apply this year, of course, with either a new project or advances from your previous work. And there's a spot on the application form to talk about progress, and of course, any potential overlap should be addressed. So for expenses, be sure that you ask for and justify what you need to do what you propose. So it should be really clear that the work that's proposed lines up with the funding that's requested. There are two budget tables. It's called the SHRF request, where there are funding partners that applies to them as well. And so the other contributions are related to things that your partners are bringing to the table. It's either cash or in kind. So outside of the organizations shown in this in the application packages. So these are other contributions that you have in place that are needed to complete the work that you've proposed. We want this grant really to be used to conduct the research. So we have a limit of $3,000 for travel to academic conferences, and the total academic knowledge sharing is limited to 10% of the total budget. So that's not related to sharing back with knowledge users outside of the academic community. And we really want you to have some resources, whether they're from the SHRF request or other contributions, to support activities that focus on sharing the knowledge outside of the academic community. There is allowable expense of time release for knowledge users, not researchers, knowledge users, for activities that are directly related to the proposed research. Industry partners that you're working with that are probably providing a letter of support. If there's a situation where you're needing to pay them for some of their services, for example, we expect that they are providing at least 50% as well through the other contributions table, either through cash or in-kind contribution. So if you're looking at that, feel free to call me and discuss what that looks like. Equipment is not eligible. If there's like really minor exceptions, make your case and we can discuss that. And be sure to look at the SHRF funding guide, as I haven't gone over every allowable expense policy, as there's ones that apply to all our programs that are outlined in the SHRF funding guide. So the application process, it consists, starts with the eligibility check. And the reason we do that is to ensure that you're on the right track, that your application is relevant to the focus area and the objectives of the funding opportunity, to ensure that the person named as a principal applicant is eligible to hold the grant, and it helps us put together that review committee to ensure we have the right expertise and representation. And of course, we work with our partners to confirm relevance early on, and just really to formalize that process so any decisions that are made are documented. Sometimes questions come up during the review process and we can just look back to those decisions. We only share specific information with the reviewers. They don't see your eligibility submission, so you don't have to worry that, you know, if your application evolves, of course, you still have to meet relevance at full application for the focus areas and partners. But yeah, don't be concerned that the reviewer is going to be comparing your eligibility and your full application. So it's just the SHRF program staff and the partners that would be looking at your eligibility submission. And it's a rolling intake and approval process. So yeah, you don't have to wait until September. You can contact us to discuss. You could submit your eligibility as soon as you're ready. And if it involves reaching out to a partner, we'll do that and get back to you as soon as possible to let you know if we have any questions or if you're good to go ahead. So once you're through eligibility, you have the full application to submit by November 17th. And be sure you're clicked on the proper call for either Innovation Grant or Impact Grant. Most of the questions are the same. There's a key difference that the Innovation Grant research proposal is 6 pages maximum and the Impact Grant is 8 pages maximum. There's space to talk about sex and gender considerations. You can upload a 1-page timeline in whatever visual format makes sense. You can attach your reference list. There's a budget, so there's the 2 Excel sheets that to complete on there that I mentioned before. I upload the justification document separately. And then the contribution forms, don't leave these to the last minute. The contribution forms require other people besides the principal applicant to log into the RMS and complete a small amount of information just about their expertise or experience. So if they're a researcher, they'd be uploading their CV. If they're a patient, they'd be putting in a testimonial and indicating their role on the project. Now, we know that, you know, for some people that are involved in the application, this is not an appropriate thing to ask of them. And so we do have ways to work around that. We'll figure out a way. You know, if someone doesn't have a computer, doesn't have a way to log in, we have ways to work around that. Just give us a shout and we'll figure it out. No worries there. There's the impact description that I'll expand on in the next slide, and make sure you leave time to get that research office signature. That's required before you submit it to SHRF. So we use what's called the Canadian Academy of Health Sciences Impact Framework, and it has these 5 areas here. And yeah, so it really gives a framework for talking about the actual and potential impacts and outputs from your project. So the peer review process, so we'll have multidisciplinary committee from across Canada. It won't include people from Saskatchewan. There'd obviously be a lot of conflict of interest. So all the members are from across Canada outside Saskatchewan. Two lead reviewers look at the application in detail and provide comments about the strengths and weaknesses. And if needed, we can bring in external reviewers for advice if it's a really specialized area, for example. And then we bring everyone together for a live virtual discussion. And if you want to read more about the process, the peer review guidelines are on our website. There's no secrets about how the process plays out. The minimum score, like all of our funding programs, is 3.5 out of 5. And the funding is allocated, as we mentioned, the funding is allocated top down in each funding envelope. So if you think about those seven envelopes in that table, we start with that. And then the program manager and funding partners, will work together to ensure we can fund as many applications as possible, which may mean, for example, if there is an impact grant that applied to virtual care, that they could be funded through the role in remote, for example. So the review criteria, this is a snapshot. Be sure to take some time and read through the review criteria. They're in the program guide. They're exactly how the reviewers see them. And the reviewers, they're volunteers, and they take really great care in trying to honor what SHRF has set out in terms of program purpose, objectives, the focus area, and these review criteria. So it's important for you to read them as well. So everyone's working from the same page here. So relevance and need is 25%. So this is really about the context, focus area fit, rationale, and how you bring people together from knowledge users, people with lived experience, supporters, that's really in context there. The quality of the proposal, so that's looking at the approach, the team, the work plan, resources, and also whether they can easily read your application. So that's 50%. And don't underestimate the readability, because it's really important for those reviewers to easily understand what you're proposing. And the potential for impact, so the significance of the planned outputs and impacts, the potential for this to move the research forward, your plans for knowledge sharing, and what you talked about in those CAS impact categories. So that's 25%. So this is my last sort of information slide. Just a few tips that you may have seen in our other presentations, but doesn't hurt just to go over them again. I know the application packages are long. We put everything in one spot so you don't have to jump around too much. So just, set aside half an hour and read it cover to cover, and let us, know if there's anything unclear in there, and we can talk about that. And if we really didn't say it properly, we can, make a clarification on our website so other people will have that information as well. When you're in your proposal, you really want to grab the reviewer's interest. Something that happens a lot of times is as people who work in that area, you think that the importance is sort of obvious, but it's important to put the importance out there, the scope of the issue, the importance of your research right up front there to really position your application as interesting and important. So make your case. Detail the how, so the person reading it should really be able to envision how this project is going to play out. And that includes potential bumps in the road. So the reader might be, reading it and say, well, that's going to be difficult. So just go ahead and address it. And they want to see that you've thought that through and have some backup plans, that you've thought it through. make it easy to read, and that includes checking your math. So the Excel budget sheets and the justification should match. If you're making any last minute changes, be sure to check both documents. Otherwise, it gets really confusing for the reviewers. And leave some time to take your application out for other people to read it and provide any feedback. And then go back to the application package and make sure that you've addressed all of the criteria in there. So next steps, we will post a copy of this presentation on our website. If we have, you know, sort of a series of questions, we'll post those frequently asked questions on our website. If there's, you know, clearly some confusion about anything, we'll clarify that on our website. And we're looking at potentially having some additional Q&A events with our partners to really maybe delve into what they're looking for, and just have an opportunity to just talk about those opportunities. And don't be afraid to contact us to talk about the fit with the program and the focus areas anytime. Earlier the better. So Karen Tilsley, that's me. You can email me. You can email Tanya if you have any questions about the RMS or the form or the RMS, the package, anything like that. She can help you. And we also have an email address, fundinginfo@shrf.ca, that our whole team looks at. You may also hear back from Danny Robertson Borsma or Chelsea Cunningham on our team that will also be helping with this program. So we have time for questions, and no questions have popped up. So I guess I was just so clear today. So I'll hang out here, see if anybody has questions. Otherwise, thank you so much for taking the time to join, and hopefully this presentation helped to just put some context around the calls and what we're looking for. So if you have any like really specific questions, feel free to follow up by email about anything that you think everyone would benefit from. Feel free to put those questions here. So someone's just wanting to confirm that there's no innovation grant for the collective impact focus. That's correct. So we have at least $450,000 available, which is equivalent to 3 impact grants. So we're only looking to fund impact for the rural and remote healthcare. And Mamadi, you have a question about the travel and budget. If you want to type that in or follow up, either follow up with me after, either way works. Just talk about one part of the eligibility form the part in the eligibility form where you talk about which focus area or partnered opportunity you're applying to. And sometimes people are writing essays in there. So we've reduced the amount of characters that you have available because we really just want you to say virtual care / Mental Health Research Canada, or virtual care, no partner, or Alzheimer's Society, Alzheimer's disease and dementia. So it's really just a focus area and partner opportunity if applicable. So like 5 words at most. And then you have another spot on the application to talk about what you're proposing and justify how that is relevant to the focus area. Okay, I'm not seeing any other questions. Okay, here's one. If you're resubmitting, so if you're resubmitting an application, it doesn't matter which call it was under. Honestly, even if it was to a different competition, it doesn't hurt to talk about the, if you're resubmitting the application, take the chance to talk about how you responded to reviewer comments. So hopefully that answers that question. So I would definitely err on the side of checking resubmission and replying to reviewers' comments. But again, if you have a question, let us know. Okay, someone has a question about the virtual care and the Center for Aging and Brain Health partnership. Why the allocation was left blank. Sometimes these conversations just, they're definitely on board. There'll definitely be partnerships, either innovation or impact grant, that was left blank on purpose because we're still figuring that out. Are the key areas that they're looking for? Nope, just applications that meet for the CABI, Brain Health and Innovation. If you want to look at their website, have a look in the application package, it's really anything that is a fit with their mandate and, of course, also the virtual care focus area. I'm going to wait another minute or two here just to see if there are any more questions. So we will send out the slides and post the presentation. So be sure to share with your colleagues and let us know if you have any questions. Okay, here's a question just popped up. If you're unsure if your research fits in a particular area, who's the best person to contact? Start with me, Karen Tilsley, and we can go from there. So if I want to bring in one of the partners, we can do that. And yeah. Okay. All right. Well, again, a few thanks and thank you for joining. It's interesting talking into the computer void in these webinars, but then everyone can watch this at a later date if needed. So thanks again for joining live or watching it later. Okay, have a great day, everybody.